Let's give God praise today. He's here with us. He's here for us. And for those of you that are watching us online, we welcome you again to Word of Life. Come on, let's give God praise again. You can do better than that. We serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He says, nothing is impossible with me. Amen. The healing power of God is flowing right now in Jesus' name. So I want to give liberty to that healing virtue. And there is no time or distance in the realm of the Spirit. If you're with us online, God is ministering healing to us. He sent His word to heal us and to deliver us from all destruction. In this series, we're looking for God answers for our relationships. And His answer for our lives is that He would be at the forefront. Just as we received our tithes and offerings, and Jonathan said, put God first. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, His way of doing and being right, and then everything else will be added to us. And so right now, let's give liberty to the Spirit of God, who is here to heal, who is here to strengthen, who is here to encourage. Are we facing something that is difficult, or we feel a little overwhelmed by what's going on? Do we have loved ones that need God's supernatural intervention of healing, of strength, of breakthrough, salvation, restoration, and wholeness? Come on, if you're needing healing or you're needing God to touch your loved ones that are on our hearts today, lift one hand up towards heaven. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank You, Lord God, that You're present with us right now. We thank You, Father God, that You are healer, You are restorer, You are our breakthrough, God. You're doing a work in our lives right now, even in our bodies. We speak to our bodies to come in line with the Word of God. We speak life over our bodies. The blood of Jesus was poured out so that we would be whole and healed in Jesus' name. Father, we thank You. By Your stripes, we are the healed of the Lord. By Your stripes, our loved ones are the healed of the Lord in Jesus' name. Father, we thank You that You want us all saved and that none would perish. Father, thank You, Father, for Your saving power being extended, Lord God, Your goodness and Your mercy drawing us and our loved ones to want to know You, to want to be committed to You, to want to be surrendered to You. We give You liberty in this place. We give You liberty in the lives of our loved ones. We cast our cares. We give everything to You, Lord God. We're not going to be anxious. We're not going to be worried. We give it all to You today, Lord God, and we trust You. We give all of them, everything, Lord God, that's concerning us. We refuse to accept pressure. We refuse, Lord God, to come under the circumstances. But Lord, we look to You and we thank You, Father God, that You're able and willing to do exceedingly abundantly above all we could dare ask or think. Show Yourself strong, Father God. Thank You, Father God, for hovering over us as Your sons and daughters. Thank You, Father God, for embracing even those that are with us online. God's love never fails, and He's extending His goodness to you. You're not alone. Let's open our hearts to Jesus today. Let's put Him at the forefront. Let's want what He wants. Let's give our lives to live our lives the way He needs us to be His ambassadors, to be His representatives, where we say, not my will, but Your will be done. Less of me, God, and more of You. That we can come to the place where it's none of me, God, and all of You. Have Your way, Father. We thank You for Your faithfulness. We thank You for Your healing power. We thank You, Lord God. Sickness and disease in Jesus' name is cursed, and sickness and disease is covered by the blood of Jesus. And there's a cleansing, there's a flow of God's healing virtue. The blood of Jesus is cleansing us and bringing wholeness to us, even for those of us online. There's God's presence. There's God's presence. He's embracing us. There's God's presence. There's His goodness embracing us. There He is for us. There He is. He's a good God. He's a good God. He's a faithful God. Let's let Him have His way. Say this after me. Say, thank You, Lord, for bringing me here today to spend this time with You. I open my heart to You once again, and I thank You that You will speak into my life to strengthen me, to heal me, to restore me from the inside out in Jesus' name. Let's give God praise. Amen. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. I love You, Jesus. Pastor Art has been doing such a phenomenal job on this series called Answers, about how to get God's answers for our relationships. And that Davidson family was kind of showing off some families that get challenged in life because we're really not doing things God's way. But I was grateful that there was some hope even for the Davidsons. You know, the video that we saw before we got started? the Elisa family was acting like the Davidsons, but they have hope for them because at the end of it all, they recognized that they needed answers. They recognized that they didn't want to do it their way anymore, but look to what answers are available to them. And our answer is still Jesus. That sounds like such a coined phrase, but it's because Jesus is the Word. Our answer is the Word of God. He is the Word. Our answer is to do life God's way. Matthew 6:33 says, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, his way of doing and being right, and then everything that we have need of, everything that we desire will be added to us. So if we want to be strengthened, we know that we need to be strengthened in our relationships, in our marriages, with our kids, on the job, everywhere that we go, being God's ambassador, then put God first. We're doing that by being here today, and even for those of you that are online, again, welcome. We're excited for what God is going to continue to do in our lives today in Jesus' name. Amen. We are needing to declare that this is our year for faith conquest. This is our year for breakthrough. This is our year, minute by minute, hour by hour, day by day. The answer to our relationship issues, of course, as I said, is Jesus, who is the Word. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, three in one, but one. And our answer is who he is. It's love. So if you're taking notes today, the title of our message today is Strong Love Produces Strong Faith for Conquest. Strong love produces strong faith for conquest. Say that with me. Strong love produces strong faith for conquest. One more time. Strong love produces strong faith for conquest. Conquest, the definition we'd given to conquest is the relentless determination to overcome life's challenges and fulfill God's purpose by faith. God's got a purpose for our lives individually. God's got a purpose for our marriage. He's got a purpose for our family. He's got a purpose for our doing in business, whether we're owners or we are working in a particular area. He's got a purpose for our lives. But we're going to see that purpose come to pass, the God plan, because we're going to live by faith, trusting him, looking to him, doing our life his way. And we've got to be relentless about it. We've got to be determined. We've got to have that dogged determination. You know, they say we need to be walking by bulldog faith. Bulldogs, they say, once they get a hold of something, they don't let go until they get distracted by something else that they want. But we got to be God's people who hold on to the Word of God no matter what until that breakthrough is manifested. So no matter what we're facing, Jesus is the answer. His word is the answer. And he is love. So he declared over us, and Pastor Art gave us this powerful word from Hebrews 6:14. Say it with me. Surely blessing, I will bless you. Say it with me. Surely blessing, I will bless you. And multiplying, I will multiply you. Once again, say that. Surely blessing, I will bless you. And multiplying, I will multiply you. What does he want to multiply? The bad things? No, the blessings, the breakthroughs, the victories, the miracles, his supernatural intervention. That's the blessing of God in every area, for every area, for every relationship. But in order for us to see that manifested, we've got to press in by faith. We've got to press in accordance to the Word of God. Faith comes by hearing, Romans 10:17, and in hearing the Word of God. That's why we got to come to church. That's why we talk about being a part of a life group, because we got to keep hearing the Word of God. We've got classes available to us. We hear the Word of God. Faith keeps being strengthened, because faith, trust in God, comes by hearing the Word of God. But faith works by love. So we got to hear the Word, but then we got to know, because God is love. Say, God is love. God is love, 1 John 4. God is love. Say, God is love. God is love. And the Bible says, when I made Jesus Christ the Lord of my life, I asked Jesus into my heart. God is love. He poured love into me by the Holy Ghost, Romans 5:5. The answer for our relationships, the answer for the breakthroughs that we're looking and believing God for is to get them by faith, is to get them by trusting God, is to get them by living by the word of God and not by the circumstances. But our faith works by love. So we got to talk about building a strong walk of love to produce a strong walk of faith for conquest. We got to talk about developing our love walk, being intentional about it, being deliberate about it. All right? Are we okay? Are we glad we came today? Amen. Galatians 5, 6 in the Amplified says, faith activated and energized and expressed and working through love. Our faith in God, our faith for the breakthroughs that we're believing for our families, for whatever area. Specifically, we've been talking about answers for our relationships. We want to see those continual breakthroughs. It's going to be because of and through the love of God, which is in us. So this is really encouraging us to let Jesus be the Lord of our life, be the one who directs us, because he's love. Letting the Lord be the one directing us, trusting him. Not trying to figure things out on our own and keep fumbling because we'd like to take matters into our own hands. No. Let's just trust God. You know, once again, the Bible says his goodness draws us, leads men and women to a place of repentance. Don't be afraid to repent. Be quick about repentance. Be quick about it. Be quick about it. Be quick to say, God, forgive me. And then be quick to say to others, forgive me. And be quick to forgive. Receive his forgiveness and then release that forgiveness to others. It's not a feeling, it's a decision. I don't have God in me because I felt like he came in. It's because I decided to ask him in and believed him to be Lord. I believed in my heart and I declared out of my mouth, Jesus, you are my Lord. I believe that he did for me what he did for all of humanity over 2,000 years ago, that he died for our sins. And though he died and was buried on the third day, he rose again. And then after 40 days of walking with his disciples and ministering to them and giving them direction about his mission, the commission, about the mission for our lives to win souls and make disciples, he then ascended into heaven where he's seated right now at God's right hand praying for us. I want to be more like him. I want to live my life in accordance to what he says. The world, our friends, our family will know that we are committed to the Lord because of our love walk. They'll either think, huh? I thought you said you love Jesus. I thought you said you're a Christian. I thought you said you're a man or woman of God, but I'm not seeing that in your life. You don't sound like that. You don't act like that. What does it say in John 13:35? By this all will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another. So if we'll be determined to press in and develop a strong love walk, it's going to produce a strong faith walk to get the conquest that God's got for our lives, because he withholds no good thing. Can we give God praise for that right now? I said, if we'll go after a strong love walk, it will develop a strong faith walk, and we will have great conquests in every area. Amen? They will know that we are his committed disciples. They're going to know people in our family. That's usually where we let our hair down, so to speak. We're all nice and neat and, you know, putting on the good face and the smile and the tone of voice, so nice, outside of the home. And then we go home and we say, well, I just gotta be me. Well, who were you on the outside? Who was that? We got to be willing to be complete in God, in the home, outside of the home, on the platform, off the platform. Who I be is who I is. Who I is who I be. Imperfect, don't have it all together. That's why I need Jesus. That's why I'm grateful that he gave us a declaration for this year of faith conquest. That's why I'm grateful that he gave us a declaration of blessing and multiplying of those blessings. Multiplying of his goodness, multiplying of his miracle working power. Amen? I want to do my life his way. How about you? I want to live in accordance to who he is, who lives in me. I want to live in accordance to his love. That brings me to the four kinds of love that are described in these four Greek words, so we can understand how our love can be implemented in and placed in our lives through these different kinds of relationship. The first and foremost and the greatest is the agape love. Agape. Agape, the Greek word agape. It's the God kind of love. It's the love of God that he poured in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. 1 Corinthians 13:8 says, it's that God kind of love that never fails. It's that God kind of love that's unconditional. That's the love that in John 3:16 said, God so loved the world that he gave his very best. He gave his son Jesus because it was that unconditional, unending love that says, I don't care how humanity is acting. I recognize that their only means to get free of the enemy's hold, the only means for them to fulfill my God purpose for their lives is if Jesus would pay the price for humanity's sin, which he did over 2,000 years ago. God so loved, it was that agape love. He is love. He is agape love. Say agape. The second kind of love is the word storge. Storge. It has to do with our family love. It has to do with our interaction and our relationships in the home with our siblings. Storge love. With our parents, our extended family, if we're married and our parents, you know, are elsewhere, or maybe they, you know, they might even still be with us or what have you in terms of in our home, but it's that love that we extend to our family, okay? And then there's the third kind of love, the Greek word is phileo. That's where you get the word or the name of the city, Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. Philadelphia, a city in, thank you, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. But that phileo love is brotherly love. It's a friendship kind of love. It's the love that says, I like you. You know, sometimes I'll hear people in our marriage relationships, I love you, but I don't like you right now. But the phileo love is that friendship love that is willing to be patient with our friends. We'll go the extra mile. Sometimes we'll find ourselves, you know, wanting to get out of that friendship because it's not a God friendship. But if when we know it's a covenant friendship, we just don't give up and we don't let go, right? The Bible says a friend will stick closer than a brother. It just has to do with that willingness to go that extra mile because we're not caught up with an obligation. It's not a relationship based on obligation. It's a real wanting to be in that relationship. Phileo. And the next kind of love, okay, I know it's a 9 o'clock service. Maybe we should have somebody distract us over there. So you don't watch all of this. Praise the Lord. I apologize. I've got something in my mouth, and I wish I had enough for all of us so that I wasn't the only one benefiting from this, but I wasn't prepared, so please forgive me. If you have one yourself, then take it out now. Praise the Lord. Phileo. It's a friendship love. And isn't it true, though, in our friendships, we'll find ourselves a lot more forgiving, a lot more yielding, a lot more flexible. But in our marriage relationships, we, like, draw the line right there. Now, we're going to learn some things, though. Amen? And then the last Greek word, last in my list is eros, physical or sexual love. Too often in the world, because we want what we want our way, relationships will often start off sexual. The eros is at the forefront. And then we get all messed up. And then we don't even like each other because we were only prompted by passion. And then we wake up, turn the lights on, and oh my gosh, what have I done? That's why we need to put first things first, the agape love. We've got to put God at the forefront, His word at the forefront. He's still got answers for us for every area of our life, and He wants us to live in accordance to His truth. Facts may be what they are, we're not in denial, but His truth will always override the facts. So we've got to know His truth, amen? That's why we come to church, that's why we go to life group, that's why we're involved in classes. We've got an encounter weekend that's been going on, and people are getting truth, and that truth is setting us free, amen? So the agape kind of love is the greatest love. That's who God is. He is agape, and yet He's got a friendship with us, and yet He's an understanding father of being family. That's why we become the family of God. It's that storge understanding of we're family, so we're extending that love of God in our family relationship. And there's phileo in God's love. It's where we're wanting to like somebody, and we're wanting to go the extra mile and be flexible. The God kind of love really has all of this, but in the eros situation, in God's love, it's in marriage. It's for marriage only. Look at your neighbor, say, marriage only. Sex is for marriage only. We got a little quieter there. That was like, whoa, did she say that? If we don't get it right in church, then we're going to get it wrong from learning from the outside. Let's learn from what God says. Amen? So God wants us to place His love in our families. It needs to be agape storge. It needs to be agape phileo. His love in our friendships. It needs to be agape eros, that it's His love in our marriages, in our sexual intimacy. But it's God's way, not what the world says, not what's demeaning, not what's perverted. That's not God's love. It's His love is caring. His love is deferring. It's not forceful. It doesn't make us a doormat. It's caring, it's caressing, it's deferring. What do you want? What's good for you? In marriage, put the agape love in our intimacy. Let's allow His love to begin to develop a friendship between husbands and wives, because there's more of a likability. There's greater tolerance. There's greater flexibility in friendships. Let's put the agape love, the God kind of love, in our families, in the storge, with how we're dealing with our children. Amen? It's getting a little quiet in this holy place. So go with me to Ephesians chapter 5, and I'm going to begin at verse 1, and then go to verse 2 in the Message Bible. Watch what God does, and then you do it. Like children who learn proper behavior from their parents, mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with Him and learn a life of love. Observe how Christ loved us. His love was not cautious but extravagant. He didn't hold back. He gave all, big, loud. Amen. Excuse me. He didn't love in order to get something from us, but to give everything of Himself to us. Love like that. Say love like that. You know, Ephesians 5 and verse 1. Let me go there. Girls, eat potato chips. Galatians, Ephesians, Colossians, Philippians. No. Galatians, Ephesians, girls, eat. Yeah. Philippians, Colossians, potato chips. See how that helps? Okay. Ephesians 5:1. Therefore, be imitators of God, copy Him, and follow His example, as well-beloved children imitate their father, and walk in love, esteeming and delighting in one another, as Christ loved us and gave Himself up for us, a slain offering and sacrifice to God for you so that it became a sweet fragrance. We need to be a sweeter fragrance with one another. When we come into the room, I pray that people don't run away, but rather they're drawn to want to get to know us, because it's the God in us, it's love that's at the forefront. Amen? Because we're imitating him, and he is love. And he so loved, he gave his best. So in our lives, in every area of our lives, and in every relationship of our lives, everywhere that we go, if we are a child of God, we belong to him first. So how we do our life should be in accordance to what he says, not what we think or the world says. Or how the way we were raised, or based on culture, if it's not based on the word, get back to the word. Put everything else under the word. Amen? So, Ephesians 5, at the get-go, God says, imitate me, and the way that I walk is I walk by love. So go after that kind of love. In Ephesians 5 and verse 21, I'm going to go all the way down there. He says, out of respect for Christ, no, I don't want to go there first. I want to go to verse 17. Let's go to verse 17. Would you go there? Would you read that with me, please? Don't live carelessly, unthinkingly. Make sure you understand what the master wants. So if the will of the Lord, if God is love and he says follow him and imitate his way, his example of being love, and live our lives in accordance to that. Verse 17, go back there again and say, show it to me in the Message Bible. Read this with me. Don't live carelessly, unthinkingly. Make sure you understand what the master wants. What does he want? He wants us to imitate him. What's he want us to live like and walk by? His love, because he is love. The Amplified Classic, verse 17, and this is a verse that was shared at an encounter for our leaders last weekend. Pastor Art had brought us to this powerful verse. He says, therefore, do not be vague and thoughtless and foolish, but understanding and firmly grasping what the will of the Lord is. What's the will of the Lord? What does the master want? He wants us to, verses 1 and 2, imitate him. Follow his example. Who is he? He is love. How does he conduct himself? Motivated by love, because he's love. How is he encouraging us to live our lives and conduct our lives? By love. So the will of the Lord that he wants us to get a hold of today and every day is that we live strong in the love of God. We walk strong in the love of God. We handle ourselves in relationships strong in the love of God, with the love of God. Amen? So that we can see our faith strong for the breakthroughs that God has for us. Strong love produces strong faith for conquest. Strong love, walking in this love, being who God's called us to be with his love, who he is living in us, being deliberate in how we walk with that God kind of love, the agape, unconditional, added to our relationships in our families. Not what culture says. What does God say? Culture can be great, but if it's asking us to do something contrary to the word of God, we better get back to the word, because then we get back to God and we're getting back to being an imitator of him, so that we can get the unconditional, unfailing breakthroughs that we're believing God for that works by love. We bring the love of God into our friendships so we can love people with phileo and have a friend on the job. And we're going to love them with the love of God in that friendship. But that doesn't mean that we're going to go and comply to a lifestyle that they're having at this time, because they don't yet know the truth of who God is, and they can be set free if they give themselves to him. But we comply and we compromise what we already know because we're trying to love them. Don't go out missionary dating. That's foolishness. I'm trying to win this person to Christ. No, they're just trying to win you into bed. And you're kind of desperate and almost pretty much willing to go and going to blame it on the devil. I don't think so. We have our own will. So bring God's love into our family. Bring God's love into our friendships. And bring God's love into our, in marriage, say in marriage, in our sexual intimacy. Bring God's love. Amen? Are we sensing the Holy Ghost kind of meddling in our poi right now? Is he getting into our Kool-Aid? Oh, man, who told her? Whatever. I don't know nothing. But the Holy Ghost wants to help us all. Say, have your way, Holy Spirit. Come on, say, have your way, Holy Spirit. Come on, we don't want to stay stuck. We really want freedom. We really want breakthrough. This is our year for conquest, but it will come by faith. But faith works by love. We don't get strong in love. We're not going to be strong in faith for the breakthroughs that God has for us for every area of our lives. Amen? All right, time is my friend, not my enemy. Ephesians 5:21 says, out of respect for Christ, be courteously reverent to one another. Amplified says, be subject to one another out of reverence for Christ the Messiah. Be subject, be submitted. Because it goes on to say in verses 22 through 33, it talks about our love relationship in the marriage. It talks about a relationship in the marriage. If we don't love God and yield ourselves wholeheartedly to Him and let Him be number one, which is based on His word, we're not going to handle ourselves well, and we're certainly not going to handle others well. We got to love God. Matthew 22, 37 through 38, right? We got to love God and love people as we love ourselves. 37 through 39. Just added that extra verse there. It's not going to go up on the screen. Sorry. You got to really look it up. Wow. Hard copy Bible, or use that smart device. It's not smarter than you when you use it to learn the word. Just learn how to use it. Amen? Okay. So, real quick. I'm going to read through Ephesians 22 through 33, because Pastor Art's been talking to us about marriage a lot, relationships, and he did a powerful time of ministry last week, basically encouraging us to all be open to let God have His way with us. Right? So let's go to Ephesians 5 and 22 through 33, because He wants us to imitate Him. He wants us to walk in love, because that's who He is. That's the example He set. That's the life we've got to follow. He wants us to realize that He's got a will and a plan for our lives and to go after that. And His will is to imitate Him and to walk in His love in a strong way everywhere, every day, in every relationship, in every situation. Amen? And then to be encouraging and supportive of one another in Christ. Then He says, wives, understand and support your husbands in ways that show your support for Christ. The husband provides leadership to his wife the way Christ does to His church, not by domineering, but by cherishing. So just as the church submits to Christ as He exercises such leadership, wives should likewise submit to their husbands, their own husbands. Not just any husband out there. Our own, speaking to us who are married. Husbands, can we begin reading from verse 25? Let's read together. Husbands, read it real strong. Husbands, men, I should be hearing you even stronger, because when you want to be strong, you can be strong. I'm hearing the ladies sound a lot louder right now. Come on. Husbands, go all out in your love for your wives, exactly as Christ did for the church, a love marked by giving, not getting. We should all be reading together. Christ's love makes the church whole. His words evoke her beauty. Everything he does and says is designed to bring the best out of her. Dressing her in dazzling white silk, radiant with holiness. And that is how husbands ought to love their wives. They're really doing themselves a favor since they're already one in marriage. Continue on, verse 29. No one abuses his own body, does he? No, he feeds and pampers it. That's how Christ treats us, the church, since we are part of his body. And this is why a man leaves father and mother and cherishes his wife. No longer two, they become one flesh. This is a huge mystery, and I don't pretend to understand it all. What is clearest to me is the way Christ treats the church. And this provides a good picture of how each husband is to treat his wife, loving himself in loving her, and how each wife is to honor her husband, Selah. The word Selah means think on that, meditate on that. Give your attention to this. Now, we can go on for weeks just on these verses right there to break it down. But bottom line, this is for everybody. Because in order for us to be effective in our marriage, we've got to first and foremost give ourselves to God and follow him, his way of doing and being right as a man and woman of God. I'm his daughter before I'm Art Sepulveda's wife. I'm his girl before I'm my children's mom and my grandchildren's Mimi. Even before I was my parents' daughter, he knew me before I entered into my mother's womb. And he loved me as he loves all of us. And he has a plan for all of us. And he had a plan for me before I entered my mother's womb. It was a plan motivated with his love. It was a plan that I would be wooed to him. He loves us first. That's why we love. We love God because he first loved us. So these verses, I want to encourage us in our marriages. Let the Holy Spirit deal with us as husbands and talk with us as wives. It really has to do with regarding one another. Your role, husband, as a husband, you have a leadership role with your wife and in your home, but it's not a role of dominance. Leadership doesn't mean domineering. It means I'm going to walk alongside you to help you to be the best you that you can be, and you're going to help me to be the best me that I can be because God's at the center of it all. We're both individually going to be imitators of him. We're going to both individually love him and let him love us, and we're going to love with his love to others, inclusive of our marriage and with our children and in every relationship and everywhere that we go. Verse 21 precedes all of the discussion about our relationship as husbands and wives, because we are all the body of Christ and we are the bride of Christ. We are all, as children of God, it's not about gender, male or female, we are all the bride of Christ. And so you men can kind of be tilted a bit about that, but don't get weirded out. It just means that you have Jesus as the one who's looking over you, caring for you, leading us. But he leads us together. So a leader has a role of responsibility, but it's not a role of dominance. And a wife, Pastor Art used that scripture about understanding your wives and being tender-hearted towards them in the book of Luke, because they're the weaker vessel. It doesn't make us lesser. It doesn't make us, we're under you. We're really to be walking alongside you. Because when we were created by God as women, and at the beginning of Genesis, women were taken from Adam's side, not from his feet, to lord over us, to dominate us, but by his side so that we would walk together, jointly together, heirs together in the grace of life. There's a lot more that I can go on. This is like, we need a marriage encounter. But husbands, if you just recognize God has graced you and anointed to be the husband of your wife, not every wife, just yours. But you're anointed for her. And she was created by God to adapt to you so that you can walk together regarding one another. Verse 21 says, regard, love, revere, honor, respect one another as a man and woman of God first, so that in marriage we won't mishandle ourselves. We won't take the I'm the head and I'm the husband thing and then make us doormats. That's a sign of insecurity. That's a sign that we need healing. God loves you, mighty men. Let go of the past. Let go of the hurts by faith. Choose to forgive by faith. Embrace the love of God and who He is and wants to continue to be in you, for you, and through you. Amen? But we've got to take the time to let God be the one who's at the forefront. This is the will of the Lord. Conduct our lives individually, following Him, walking in love. That's what He wants us to grasp a hold of, His will, His way of doing and being right. And then He says, honor one another as men and women of God. And then in your marriage, it won't be difficult for wives to be revering and honoring and respecting of our husbands, because you're a mighty man of God, and we see you as a mighty man of God, fulfilling the call of God on your life, and will undergird you and be your greatest cheerleader, because you're called by God to love us as Christ loved the church, and you're to lay your life down for us. Wow. You're graced for that. You're anointed for that. Don't get in the flesh about it. Don't think it's unfair. How come I got to do all this giving? Where's the wife's giving? Oh, no, no, no. We're praying behind you. We're cheering behind you. We're undergirding you. We're respecting you. But it's not in a case of dominance. It's completing one another in the Lord. We're complete in Him as individuals. That's what makes a strong marriage, is getting whole in God for ourselves. And then when we get married to another whole in God individual, whew, we're going someplace to happen to advance the kingdom. But when we shortchange ourselves because Eros kind of love, sexual love, passion was at the forefront, and God gets kicked out, turn off the light, we forget that we're a child of God, and we're trying to get all act out like we don't know the truth, and we do, and the Holy Ghost is trying to get us all the while, but we're shutting Him down because our passions are just getting the best of us. We can still be on the other side, if we'll just say, God, I repent, forgive me. I give myself back to you. I thank you for your unconditional love. Amen. Stand to your feet if you would, please. God's presence is here with us. He loves us. He wants to help us in our marriages. He wants to help us in our friendships. He wants to help us with our families. He wants to help us in the intimacy of our married lives. He wants to strengthen us. Healing is still here for us right now. But He says, give yourself to me. Follow after me. Be submitted. Surrender to me. I love that. I love what Pastor Art said a few years ago. If I'll do the surrender, God will do the amazing. And I love Pastor Sessa's phrase, if I change, everything will change. Starts with me. Starts with me. It's not looking out at you. If my husband just did this, my kids did that. No, God, work with me. And I am not a perfect person. My kids can tell you. My husband can tell you, my grandchildren can tell you, the ones closest to us, they know. God have mercy. But we're surrendering to God, and we're going to repent, and we're going to forgive, and we're going to put God at the forefront. We're going to follow what His word says. We're going to be in an environment like this. We're going to come to church whenever the doors are open. We're going to get to life group to be in an environment where God's speaking, God's working, miracles are at hand. We're going to undergird one another in Jesus' name. We're going to get to the classes that are going to help us to grow in God. We're going to continue to want what God wants, to be who He's called us to be in Jesus' name. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Father, I thank you for your hand upon each and every person here today, and even for those that are watching online. Thank you, Father God, for your goodness and your mercy being extended to us today. You've got arms open wide to each and every one of us with your unconditional, unfailing love. And you're wooing us to you. You're wooing us. For some, it's the first time. For others, it's to come back to you. Because you love us and you've got an amazing plan for our lives. And you want to strengthen us in every area, in every relationship, in everything we do, everything we say. You want to show yourself strong on our behalf. So, Father, I thank you for extending your hand of grace and mercy to us today. As heads are bowed and eyes are closed, and the family of God is praying, if you're here and you say, Pastor Ken, I'm not sure where I stand with God, but I know I need Jesus. I need him in my life. I need him to help me. I need him to work with me. I know, I recognize, I need him. I want to follow him. I don't want to do my own thing. I want to go God's way. And I want to follow his walk of love, because I need that. I need that for my own life, so that I can give that to others around me. Jesus said you must be born again in order for you to understand all that the kingdom of God in heaven has for us. You just need to open your heart to him and let him be the one who lives in the center of your heart, in the center of your life. If you're here today and you say, Pastor Kuna, I want to be surrendered to God. I want to give myself to the Lord. I want to be a child of God. I want to be born again. Lift that hand up real high. Let me see your hand real high so that I can know that you need God. I can pray with you. Thank you. God bless you. Anyone else? Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. Up in the balcony. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. Hands going up. I need Jesus. Thank you. God bless you. Anyone else? Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. More hands going up as the family of God is praying. I need Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. More hands going up. Thank you. Thank you for responding. He's given us a free will. He can't make us. But if we will be willing, he's knocking on the door of our heart and asking us, will you let me in? I want to help you. I want to meet you where you're at. Thank you. God bless you. Once you've raised that hand, you can put it back down. Thank you. Thank you. Hand still going up. Thank you. God bless you. If you have not yet raised your hand, but you know you need Jesus, your hand might be beating, your heart rather might be beating hard, and you might feel a little concerned, but don't be afraid. He's a good and a loving God. His arms are open wide. You need Jesus. You want to be a child of God. You want to be born again. If you've never said a prayer, then I want to lead you, and it's simple. It just starts with an open heart, but you know you need him, and you did not yet raise your hand. Would you slip your hand up right now? Slip it up right now. 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 I need Jesus, Pastor Kuna. Don't let this time go by. I need Jesus. I recognize. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? Anyone else? You might be here and you say, Pastor Kuna, I know what it means to be a thank you. God bless you. Thank you. I know what it means to be a child of God. I know what it means to ask Jesus into my heart. I did that sincerely a while back, and it was so awesome. I saw God. I saw his goodness. But I don't know what happened over time. I began to get distracted by other things, and I began to take my life back into my own hands, but I want to give my life back to God. I don't feel like I'm worthy. I know where I've been. I know what I've done. He understands all of that, and his love for you is still unconditional. And he receives us just as we are if we'll open our heart to him. So if you know you need to come back to God, you want to be reconnected with him, you want to get back to living for him and not your own way, but his way. You didn't raise your hand earlier, but you know you need to get back with God. On the count of three, I want you to raise it up real now, real high, because you need to come home to God. Raise it up real high. You know, you need to come back. Thank you. Thank you. One, two, three. Yeah, more hands going up. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. More hands going up. Thank you. Thank you, Lord God, for these lives that want to be recommitted and reconnected to you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. If you'll all just look up at me right now, it's been a privilege and an honor to be with you at this 9 o'clock service. Thank you for coming to the house of God where he can help us, where he can guide us, where he can speak to us. We need one another. We need to be in his house weekly. If you raised your hand, or you wish you would have raised your hand to come to God for the first time or to come back to God, I want to pray with you. I want to help you to let today be the start of a new beginning. God drew you. You responded by raising your hand. You made that decision that no one else could make for you but you alone. But now I want to help you be committed to that decision. We know what a committed decision makes. It makes a difference. We can decide something and then get talked out of it, but a committed decision helps us to fulfill that decision. And we want Jesus and everything he has for us. Amen. So if we raised our hand, or we wish we would have raised our hand to come to God for the first time or to come back to God, I want to pray with you. I'm going to take some time with you. So I'm going to ask if you would please pick up your personal belongings, step out of your nearest aisle, and come and stand with me here at the platform. I'm not going to have you say anything to embarrass you, but I want to pray for you. And I want to lead you in a prayer that's going to help you. Come on, we're clapping because all the angels in heaven are rejoicing for your decision to want Jesus, to come back to him. Come on down. Come on down. Come on down and join me here at the front. Come on from the back. Come on from the side. From the back, from this side. Come to the Lord. Come to him today. People are coming. Several hands were raised earlier. They're still coming. 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 Thank you for being open to the Lord. So I'm going to ask those of you that are here at the front, just bow your head and close your eyes, and let me lead you in a prayer. And we're all going to say this prayer with you. And all we have to do is just be sincere from our hearts. And today is our miracle day. It's the start of a new beginning. Say this after me. Just bow your heads and close your eyes and say, Lord God, thank you for this awesome time that I've gotten to spend with you. You've been speaking to me to trust you. And I'm here today with an open heart to do just that. Jesus, come into my heart. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. Be the one who directs me in everything I say and everything I do. And forgive me of all my sins and all my wrongdoings. I thank you for your blood that was shed for me, that I would be cleansed of all unrighteousness. Thank you that healing has begun in my life from the inside out. Fill me now with the power of your Holy Spirit, that I would live strong for you, that I would be your ambassador, your representative in everything I say and in everything I do. I place my life in your hands, and I thank you for this new beginning. Thank you, Lord, for surrounding me with the right people who love you and want to fulfill their God-given purpose, because that's what I need. And that's what I want. I thank you for that now, in Jesus' name.